official Queen podcast. Much like buses, don't get one for ages and then two come along at once. I hope you enjoyed the Tyler Warren Queen Extravaganza podcast. Good interview, great guy. Make sure you check those guys out when they hit the UK later this month and into November. Okay, we're talking Queen on air this time. I sat down with Greg Brooks. We discuss how a product and a project like this rolls out in our little Queen team. What's involved in getting this sort of thing together. We discuss the BBC sessions, of course, the interview discs, and the live highlights package, which also included in the product. November 4th is when you get your hands on it. Had a little listen, see what you think. I'll see you next time. Nick Weymouth signing off. Here comes Greg Brooks. Nick Weymouth sitting down with his chum and Queen archivist Greg Brooks talking Queen on air. So it's the follow-up to our last box set, isn't it? Hammersmith.
Yeah.
Bit of a change from a live release this time around, isn't it?
Yes, we've gone away from that. I think fans were expecting it to be another live thing because we did Rainbow in 2014 and then Hammersmith 2015. I think some people were thinking, oh, we'll do Hyde Park in 2016 and Earl's Court in 17. But that's really not the intention. That wasn't really our intention. It just so happened that we did Rainbow and it happened to coincide with the 40th anniversary. Then we went on to Hammersmith 75, which came out in 2015.
Yes.
So you can see how people would expect it. But we weren't really thinking, let's work to anniversaries. It just sort of looked that way.
Yeah.
So we went away from the live thing for Queen on Air, yes.
It's been a long time coming for some people, isn't it? I think the sessions are something that people have wanted for some time, haven't they?
Yeah, it's nice. For the first time ever, we've put all the sessions, all six sessions, together in on the same release. And it's nice to have it.
How does a project like this start for you? I kind of have an idea myself, but I mean, are they all different, or do you have a kind of a logical sort of plan, a step, once we've decided what we're doing?
Well, they all differ slightly in how they start. Sometimes it could be Brian or Roger have an idea and ask us to go away and look into it. Sometimes it will come from me or Justin or you or someone in the team says, why don't we look at blah blah blah. Invariably we have a team meeting. Our little team gets together, and it is quite a little team. There's myself and Justin, Chris, Richard Gray, yourself, Nick, Emma, Jim Beach, and sometimes Tildy Beach in the room. And we sit there talking and discussing, and then generally I put together a written proposal, and then Justin and Chris help with that. We knock that into shape. That goes back to Jim, who takes it back to the band. And they come back and say, yeah, we like that, we don't like that. You could consider this and drop that. And that's generally how it works.
But before that goes,
we develop it.
There's a lot of to-ing and fro-ing, isn't it? Ideas thrown around, back and forth. And put it apart, put it back together again a few times. And
It's never, here's the proposal. Yes, that's fine, do that, exactly that. I mean, Brian and Roger have very detailed ideas and, you know, they'll say, we don't like that, and why don't you do this, and we prefer this, and that would be better. Think more down that road than that.
For sure, yeah.
And then we knock it into shape, and eventually it takes a form that everybody's happy with.
Including the label,
and,
of course.
Yeah, of course. And then we go, and we, excuse me, then we try to put it together. Sometimes we get quite a way down the road of putting it together, and then it can fall apart. Or change again.
Yeah, things come up. The classic example was always a long time ago, though, when the Paul Rodgers thing came up, didn't it? And suddenly all our plans got skewed because they were playing live and they decided to make a record and all
that happened. Yeah. You could be merrily going along a road, a focused road on know what you're doing, and then suddenly, right out of the blue, everything changes. And stop that, do this. Put all your effort into that, and that's what we do. You know, we are governed by the band and the record label, and we do whatever's asked.
So breaking Queen on Air down a little bit, the main the main course, as it were, is the BBC sessions, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
All of them. That's the main thing that we're kind of focusing on, really.
The principal focus is the six sessions. So the discs, the two CDs and the three LPs, where you've got all six sessions from 73 right up to 77. Everything they ever did at the Beeb, including the first session, which was broadcast by John Peel, 5 months before Queen's debut album and single. So that is actually the very first Queen music ever broadcast anywhere in the world. Wow. Which is quite significant, and we of course cover that in the sleeve notes. So the very first session, predating the first album, right up to the News of the World session, which was actually broadcast or recorded, I can't remember which, recorded I think on the same day as News of the World was released in the UK. So lots of good stuff, different versions or alternative versions of familiar songs from Queen 1, Queen 2, Sheer Heart Attack, and News of the World.
Just looking, hello everyone, I can actually see the LPs in front of me, I've got it here. I'm just looking at it now. Any particular highlights across those sessions? I mean, where were they in session 2, session 3?
Lots of highlights, really. Session 1 and 2 from the first album, and session 3 and 4 from Queen 2. And then session 5, Sheer Heart Attack, and 6, News of the World. Lots of highlights. The first session, every track, all of those four tracks,
mm-hmm.
are all, I would say, significantly different versions to those you find on the album. I mean, that's true throughout all the sessions. Sure. That on every session, there's something very different in the way that Roger sings Modern Times Rock and Roll. On both occasions, session 3 and 4, really interesting. He also sings Tenement Fun Star on the fifth session. That's great. That's a highlight. It's Late is a big highlight for me on the last session.
Big fan favourite, It's Late, isn't it, really?
Yeah, and Spread Your Wings and We Will Rock You, Fast.
Yeah.
Because I think from this session, from that last session, when they performed that We Will Rock You, Fast, they liked it so much they took it out on tour and opened the show with the Fast version. So it's great. You hear it here in its infancy, sounding quite startlingly different. Really good, really interesting, and lots of highlights. Ogre Battle, session 3. White Queen, session 4. Oh, Liar, session 2.
So have you sat down and listened to this in its entirety all the way through, or did you
many
just,
times.
Did you just or yeah. snippets or
no, all of it. I love the sessions. I always loved the sessions. I remember listening. I don't remember the earlier ones actually listening at the time, though I must have. But certainly I listened on air to when the last session was broadcast. And that was pretty exciting, really, to hear that stuff, especially with the Herman Hesse Siddhartha thing right in the middle.
I think you should explain that to people, yeah.
Well, I won't say too much.
Give it away.
But there's a strange interlude that comes at you when you're expecting We'll Rock You, Fast. There's a slow rock you goes into the fast. And in between, there's a strange recording that happened to be on the tape that they were using to record the session. So they went in to listen to what they just recorded, and the tape played on, and they heard this strange thing, which you'll hear, and they thought, oh, that's really interesting. Completely random, obscure thing. And they left it in, and I think that's really interesting. There's lots of stuff here, actually, on these six sessions that if you've never heard before, quite fascinating, very different slant.
Have Brian and Roger, have you been in the room where Brian and Roger have commented on any of this stuff or listened to it or feedback from
No,
them?
Justin and Chris take care of the audio and taking it back to the band and getting their opinions and is that okay and what about this? And so no, I wouldn't have been in the room with them for that reason.
But I mean, are they fond of these sessions?
I think I've heard comment, and I see emails and things like that, and generally they're very impressed. I think with a lot of this stuff, it's been so long since they've heard it, like with Hammersmith and Rainbow, and they either have a good memory or a bad memory.
Yeah.
Invariably they have accurate recollections, But then they're quite shocked when they hear it. They generally, I think, oh, wow, you know, don't remember that. And I don't remember us doing that arrangement of Rock You or whatever it is. So it would be nice to sit in the room while they listen to this, but I only get sort of email. I see some email feedback, and Justin will say, yeah, they were pleasantly surprised. Roger didn't remember that. Brian didn't remember this. But they generally, both of them, have pretty good memories.
Yeah.
It's quite shocking the detail that they would remember. Hence, some of it makes it through to the sleeve notes.
Yeah, for sure.
A lot of that detail comes direct from the horse's mouth, if you like, you know.
So that's the sessions, which is obviously the two discs and the 3 LP as well. But also, we've also got the live highlights discs of... Three different shows.
Yes, on the deluxe box is 6 discs. So you get the session discs, all of the sessions. You get 3 interview discs, which we'll come to. And the 3rd disc is really Queen Live on Air. I think we called it Queen Live on Air.
To cover that.
Under the umbrella of Queen on Air. But it's really Queen's... concerts that were broadcast on air, just like the sessions were, but we didn't include Wembley because we've already done Wembley, and we did Hammersmith last year, both of which were broadcast by BBC Radio. So for this, we put out 3 gathered together, Justin and Chris did, with the band closely watching, you know. So they ended up with, I think it's about 8 songs from Golders Green, 73, from the early concerts, the early period, and then roughly the same number of songs from 81, Morumbi in Brazil, from the mid period, and then from Mannheim, Germany, from the last tour, there's 8 songs. So it just so happened that it's a nice coincidence, really, that you've got Queen Live on Air from the very early time, the mid period, and the latter years. And so you see the contrast.
For sure, yeah.
It's a huge contrast, you can imagine. And the sound, the Freddie's confidence and the whole thing, you know, the whole dynamic changes a lot in that time. So we're going from 73 right up to 86.
So just going back to 73, so what was that Golders Green show? What was it, just specifically for the BBC?
It was specifically for the Beeb, commissioned by the Beeb. I do cover it in the notes quite a bit. Produced by Jeff Griffin, who produced some of the sessions.
Right, okay.
It was his little baby, as it were, at that time, to get people like Zeppelin in, and Elton John and people like that would come in and he'd do a session. Invariably, he would have 2 artists,
okay.
two concerts and 1/2 hour each, but with Queen he gave them a bit longer. So yeah, that it was quite unusual at the time, and good profile, perfect profile for Queen, you know.
Especially that early stage in their career as well.
Just after the first album has been released and the first single, suddenly they're on BBC Radio 1. So yeah, excellent profile and a good show as well. It's been, the fans have wanted it for a long time. It's been bootlegged pretty badly, some appalling bootlegs out there. So it's nice to have this for the properly.
And the Morumbi show then. I like that period.
It's brilliant. On paper it might not grab you. I know some people have said or intimated, oh, it's Morumbi, but when they hear it, when you suddenly hear the excitement and the power, you know, that's coming at you from that gig, and the excitement of the audience and the band, and Freddie sounding in fabulous form and the band playing brilliantly, and it's just awesome, really. It really is, you know. It's you have to hear it, belt it out loud in your car or whatever, hear it loud, and I think it's a great concert. It comes across, you really get a feel of the vibe and the excitement of the night, you know.
Breaking ground, breaking
really
territory,
big time. Queen were really the first band that did South America properly on a big scale.
Just from going out there myself last year, on a very different scale, different sorts of shows, the energy and the power that comes off those audiences, you can feel it. You can absolutely feel it. There are people crying, But it was the noise was heavy, the atmosphere was heavy, but in a fun way, incredible people.
Yeah, you'd have to really be there to really get it, wouldn't you?
But that must have been something else, really. You know, waiting that time, band like that to come over.
Well, 250,000 people in two nights. I mean, that's a lot of people. It's not 70,000 people at Wembley. It's 250,000 people. Imagine walking on stage to 120,000 people and the noise that they must make and the vibe and the excitement. As you say, the energy. Anyway, so yeah, there's Morumbi and then there's the Mannheim Magic Show, which again, well, it's power and it's excitement and it happens to be the band's very last tour.
Yeah, not the most obvious selection of tracks across the disc either, is there? It's not a great hit set, is it? No,
I don't. Again, this is Justin and Chris working with the band, but they will have discussed all kinds of variations, and I'm sure the band would have steered it, you know, let's have that and not this, let's have that and that, and you don't want repetition, you know, you don't want to choose Keep Yourself Alive from Magic if it's a Golders Green or whatever, you know, you've got to be a bit sensible, and some songs will have worked better than others, I'm sure.
Yeah,
you know,
sure.
But that's really not my domain there. No. That's Justin, Chris know what they're doing, and with the band sort of guiding, I think we've ended up with a really nice selection of all three shows.
So that's the sort of music taken care of, and
yeah.
Then there's obviously these interviews, something that you clearly be heavily involved in your archiving aspect, and they always gave good interviews, didn't they, Queen? And
always,
continue to.
Absolutely. Like anybody else, depending what day you found them, what mood they were in, if they'd had a good day or a bad, obviously dictated how well the interview went, or if they were, how vicious or friendly they were, especially in Freddie's case. Sometimes he could be very sweet and relaxed and calm, and other times he could be a bit biting, you know, and a bit oversensitive or whatever, and give his interviewer a hard time.
Yeah, well, it depends what they come with. Might come with an attitude
doesn't
it?
Exactly right. So they generally respond to the person who's talking to them. But I sat and, well, I went back and re-evaluated or reassessed all the interviews we've got, and that's a lot of stuff. I shortlisted quite a bit of stuff, probably 10 or 11 hours to start with, to see how could you do this, how could you split it up. Would you split it up by project or by person? Do we put all the Roger interviews together? Do we put all the Magic interviews together? Do we do it by year? And of course the record label have a pretty good idea of how much music balance there should be on this product, balance between music and interview. So of course we've got the sessions and the live disc, so from their point of view it made sense to have three discs of interviews, so that's what I did.
It's a perfect opportunity to use that material, I guess, isn't it? Maybe if it was BBC related as well, wasn't it? So
yeah, it's difficult to know where to begin and where to cut it up. I mean, if you were doing an interview box set, you could probably have, not that anybody would want it, but you could in theory have 18 discs,
right, okay,
and do one for each year or something, certainly one for each project. But here we're trying to do an overview, just a representative overview of all those years of interviews. It made sense to go largely with BBC, so a lot of them are BBC interviews, some are Capital Radio, but they are spread right across the period, so you get Roger talking about Live Killers and Brian talking about Hot Space and Freddie on the Works, and so on and so forth. And it goes right up to the last interview, what happened to be the turned out to be the last interview they all did together, which was for Mike Reed in 89.
Yeah, they often do interviews together, maybe at the beginning and maybe at the
end.
Yeah, ending,
more so in the beginning.
Yeah.
I mean, it's noticeable if you were to draw a little graph of interviews with all the band together. It's certainly in the early days, 74, 5, 6, 7. Most of them, you know, that's when most of the all four of them together interviews occurred. And then sort of from Live Killers onwards, it tended to be one or two of them.
For sure, yeah.
And then right up to 89, they suddenly do a nice one together again. They did sometime. We have got interviews from 75 and 6, but sometimes the quality wasn't good, the sound quality. It doesn't have to be perfect sound every time, but it can't be so bad that you can hardly hear it. And some of the really good interviews that I heard, although they are interesting from what they're saying point of view, the information that they're imparting, the sound is so bad we couldn't use it.
Right.
So okay, we ended up using, you know, the band wanted us to, things that were enjoyable and informative, interesting, not necessarily sound quality was not the priority.
Did you find anything in there you hadn't heard before, or surprising little nuggets in there?
There's always nice things that you either never heard before, you can't remember because it was 30 years ago.
Yeah.
A lot of those interviews, I do remember listening to the Tom Brown interview at Christmas 77. I remember because I was supposed to be having a family Christmas and I disappeared. I mean, what are you doing? You've got the family here. Well, Queen are on the radio.
My other family's on the radio, yeah.
Yeah, well, record it. Yeah, but in those days you had to sit there to record it, you know, literally in the room,
yeah,
and hope nobody came in and made noise, yeah, you know.
Yeah, put the washing away and doors slamming.
Yeah, that was what I was doing.
Doors being opened, yeah.
In 77, that's what I was doing, listening to Queen over the Christmas break, and it was really a good interview. All four of them. In fact, might have even have been the first time I heard John speaking, John and Roger, from
right, memory. Okay.
You know, yeah, it would have been for some people anyway, the mm-hmm. first time they've actually hearing these guys that make this incredible music, actually hearing the bass player talking and Roger talking. Invariably, they're used to Brian and Freddie.
For sure.
But that probably was the first time, those early interviews. So I think what we came up with, or ended up with, was a pretty good representation of everything. There's a bit of fun there with Freddie and Kenny Everett.
Yeah.
There's some poignant stuff. There's some really interesting interviews with, especially I think the Brian one from 82, Hot Space. Roger's Live Killers one, I think really nice. And the Flash Gordon interview he gives, I think with Richard Skinner, is really good, you know.
They've got stuff to say, the smart guys, haven't they?
Always have something to say.
Articulate,
that's right. Yeah. And intelligent guys, and will always say something you're not expecting.
To this day as well, really,
yeah,
isn't it? Yeah,
of course. And then the thing is, at the time they're talking of the project, it's fresh and current. So they remember the detail. If you ask Roger now to tell you about Flash Gordon, it was 30 years ago. He'll remember maybe the basics, but not the detail of.
Mm-hmm.
So when you listen to that interview, he says things that have just happened. They've only just finished it. So of course it's going to be more detailed mm-hmm. and fresh. But no, right across the board, there's some good stuff. There's John, he's in there. I remember he says something about playing electric piano on
I listened to that the other day. Freddie doesn't like
Freddie,
it.
And he said, because Freddie didn't want to play. And Freddie interjects and says, why would you play one of those horrible electric pianos yeah. when you have a lovely grand piano?
Yeah, no, I listened to it the other day.
But John has a good retort. He says, that's the instrument that I had at home. That's what I wrote it on. So it made sense to play it on that. And John plays it. Freddie didn't. John played that piano on his song, Best Friend. So things like that. If you don't know why that electric piano is on Best Friend and who played it, well, you will do if you listen to these interviews. Take good care of what you've got, my father said to me.